Welcome, friends, to this final day of our three-day event here in Menomonie, Wisconsin. Very happy to see you here. And I must say I enjoyed working with you for these 3 days. And it was a great opportunity for me to do seva to my master, Hazur Maharaj Baba Sawan Singh Ji. As I explained in these few days, that there is a method in this journey toward our true home. First part is our effort. First part is that we try our best by more meditation, spending more time in company of master, company of other satsangis, company of like-minded people. And when we meditate with love and devotion right from the beginning. Whether we are repeating words or we are listening to the sound or merely doing dhyan, contemplation of the face of the master, all done with love and devotion. Try to have a conversation with the master inside by remembering him as you saw him last. That brings the radiant form of the master much faster in your meditational experience than merely waiting for it. So that is why remembering the master helps a lot. And one thing I have to say, that it touched my heart very much that so many people come to have a one-on-one personal time with me, an interview with me. And when I see that so many have come after waiting for a year or so, many of them from other distant places, and they go back without meeting me because the time is too short. That has touched me deeply. I don't think that is the best way. Because when I remember the few moments I would get with great masters, how important they were for me. In fact, every time I met him, whatever he said remains with me even till now. It became a part of my life. So that is why I have felt this is not the best arrangement, that people should wait and we have a priority list and then people go away without seeing me, just because they have seen me once earlier. So I have to rectify this situation, and I have requested Jonathan Rapkin, the president of Isha, that in future, any events where people have to come from distant places, I should be able to see everyone who wants to see me. Even if we have to extend the program by one more day, two more days, three more days, I would like to see everyone. This will be done for future events. I could not do it for this event because there are so many other commitments I've already made in other parts, in the Chicago and elsewhere. As some of you know, at this age, 92, I've also taken over new 4 jobs. 4 corporations have elected me as chairman of the corporation, and I am spending time. Even during my stay here, I had several business meetings in the evenings, late evenings, in addition to the work that I am doing, seva to you and to great master. So that is why a lot of my time is being taken up in these things. And I really want to express my gratitude to all of you who came, and although they waited for me, please remember, great master's blessing, my love for them, is always there, whether they were able to see me or not. I also get so many emails, hundreds of them, every day. So I spend time reading them, mostly at night, when I'm free. And it takes so much time. I used to give answers also as quickly as I could. But what would happen if I gave an answer at 12 o'clock, midnight, in 5 minutes I would get another question from the same person. I suddenly realized that the faster I try to respond, the more emails I get. So I decided that there are some very urgent matters which people ask. I respond immediately. Others are, a lot of them are general questions. Many of them, which have already been answered in my talks here. But then I can take some time and answer. Some people say, these are very important questions. Please answer all of them. Then I read 16 questions in one email. So emails have been coming till this morning, even for giving time for this event. So I do apologize to those who are not able to see me, and I will make sure that next time this will not happen, and they will definitely get a chance to have one-on-one with me. I realize the importance of that when I remember my own meeting with Great Master. Now, as I said, meditation is step by step. We should be able to do meditation as best as we can. We can try our best. It's not easy. And people say, do 2.5 hours, recommended time. The time recommended is based upon the principle that we should give to spiritual work 1/10 of our time. Total time available to us in 24 hours is 2.5 hours, 10% of it. So that is why the tithes have been recommended for 10% of your net income, and the time given for spiritual work is also 10%, 2.5 hours. It's not easy to do 2.5 hours. I have tried, and it's not easy at all. When you try to force yourself to spend 2.5 hours, then what happens? Then you are not really putting any attention on yourself, putting attention on the time. I remember sharing with some of you an experience with a friend in San Francisco. Many years ago, he had come to India. We spent very good time together. And he was very good at meditation. I used to admire him. And then he invited me to San Francisco. I came all the way from India to visit him. And when I arrived, he said, I'm so happy you're here. Now we can meditate together at 3 o'clock in the morning. I thought I would sleep that night to catch up with my jet lag. But I had to keep my face. Yes, I am an old satsangi. I am supposed to do better. So 3 o'clock by alarm, we got up. And he sat next to me, I sat next to him. And we closed our eyes, sat in a lotus position. And from time to time, it just occurred to me to see how he is doing. So from the corner of my eye, I would see like this. I don't know if it was coincidence or what. Every time I saw, he was looking at the watch like this. Every time. I said, how is it possible? I said, next time, he's watching. At the end of very difficult, arduous 2.5 hours, we got up from meditation. He said, what a great meditation we completed 2.5 hours. I said, my friend, it was very good meditation, but it was meditation on your watch. Not on yourself, not on your master, not on the spiritual path, but on your watch. I said, I happened to notice. And not only were your meditation on your watch, it became my meditation on your watch. I kept on looking at your watch the same way. Now, trying to make time as if that is such a ritual that you have to do, then you're going back to the same thing religions are doing. Follow rituals. We are perfect living masters are taking out of ceremony the rituals into true spiritual practice. And if we start doing the same thing, that just by ritual we have to do it, no matter what, nothing happens. Then we're making it another religion. So that is why you should do meditation when the urge is to do meditation. And do it with your intense love and devotion that you can. Whether it's 5 minutes or 8 hours, doesn't matter. The intensity of your love and devotion matters. How well you are able to imagine you are there and your master is there. You are talking to your master. You are flying with the master. You are doing all these things with your imaginative self. That is what creates results. That is true meditation. Not just passing time and saying that I have sat for 2.5 hours. So that is why I say that you do even 5 minutes, but do it correctly, please. Also, I say one more thing. Do it regularly. That's another thing. Do not say, I do meditation on weekends, but I do many hours every weekend. It doesn't work. You lose the momentum. Every weekend, you will start from square one. So that is why, even if you do 5 minutes, 5 minutes when you wake up in the morning, 5 minutes before you go to sleep at night, just 2 sessions. Make 2 sessions compulsory. If you make 2 sessions compulsory, the momentum keeps on going. And every time you can go more and more. And meditation becomes very pleasant, very pleasurable. In the beginning, it is very dry. What Great Master used to call it dry meditation in the beginning. but it becomes very pleasant as we keep on doing regularly. So regularity is important, and we should be able to give 5 minutes, 10 minutes, whatever you can give. Some people come to me, say, certain housewives, we have children to take care of, we have to cook food in the morning, our husband are going to work, we are very busy, how can we find time for meditation? And I ask them, do you have 5 minutes? Oh yes, 5 minutes we can find. Then give the 5 minutes. When you wake up, put it at highest priority. 5 minutes of meditation. 10 minutes what you can give. Or more if you have time. But at least 5 minutes if you give in the morning and 5 minutes before going to sleep, you are maintaining the momentum of it. And great master said that one thing we can do to make it easy is the simran part. The repetition part should be made into a habit. A habit means that you should be repeating those words mentally all the time, whether you're walking, driving, doing anything. Then it becomes very easy, that part becomes very easy. It almost becomes automatic. If you try to make it a habit, you will notice the 5 minutes you do at night and go to sleep after that, you will be doing meditation all night long. If you wake up in the middle of the night, you see your mind is saying meditation. Mind takes up habits. Mind is always very fond of putting on habits. This becomes a habit also. Similarly, when you begin to hear the sound, and you hear it consistently, 5 minutes morning, 5 minutes at night, you will be hearing it all the time while you are working, while you are doing anything. Eventually, it becomes part of your daily life. The sound that comes from the third eye center, the sound of the self, does not interfere with any other sound outside. You can have very loud sound of the bell sound inside. You can drop a pin and you can hear the sound of the pin. The two are completely different. The inner sound is heard by the self. It is emanating from the self, heard by the self. Whereas the outer sound is heard by the ears. It's a physiological thing for the body. So that is why that sound becomes a part of your existence. All the time you will hear it. You don't have to try to hear it. With these two things, when this simran or repetition goes on automatically and the sound is heard automatically, meditation is merely a question of remembering master and being within. The radiant form comes very quickly at that time. No effort is involved. It's just a natural thing that happens, and all the meditation is chatting, having a good chat with master, flying to different places, satisfying your curiosity about this universe, other universes, depending upon how curious you are. And then having a friendly discussion, friendship. I can tell you from experience, there is no greater friend that you can find than your master at the radiant form. He will be helping you in everything. And you can have access to him every time, all 24/7, 365, 366, and he will always be available to you. And will be able to share, not only share your problem, even share jokes, even share sense of humor. You'll be surprised how much sense of humor these masters have. Great master used to make people laugh, and he used to laugh too. If you see some of his old pictures, how boisterously he could laugh on some humorous situation. So that is why it's a great friendship. It's a wonderful friendship to have the master with you 24/7. And that is why we don't even feel after that whether physical presence of master is there or not. Inner presence is not only equally good, better than even the physical presence. We have a hard time finding time with the master outside. It's so easy to find him inside. That is why please practice meditation in such a way that you have access to your master all the time. It changes your life completely. Loneliness will never be a word you'll ever think of again if you have that. Some people tell me, I'm very lonely, I'm alone. And here, I have found period when I want to be alone. I say, can you give me some space of mind? Especially in the beginning, I used to run away to just be alone because I was with my master. Somebody tell me, what do you do when you are alone? I said, never alone. I've never felt alone. So it's a very beautiful experience that you have a perfect living master with you. This is a very big difference between all other kinds of yoga, samadhis, other kind of abhyas, and other kind of asanas, yogas, different types. I've tested them out. For 8 years, I did nothing else but examine all these other methods of meditation. So I am telling you, this is the best that I could find. That's why I share it with you. And it's very great that great master has given this opportunity to all of us. I congratulate all of you who are here, because this is a very great opportunity you have got. And you must be very lucky people. When we look at the rest of the world, how they are living, and how our lives have changed, we realize how lucky we are. Sometimes small things happen because of our karma and we feel bad about it. But look at the overall life changes that we have had because of being on the spiritual path. So that is why I congratulate you for this. When you do your meditation, do it from inside, not with the body. Body, if you keep the awareness of the body, it will remain with the body for a very long time. This is very important. Great Master emphasized it, that you should first place yourself, feel you are at the third eye center by imagination. Place yourself there and meditate with that body. Whatever you want to do, meditate, repeat words, listen to sound with that inner self. That helps you to withdraw your attention from the body very quickly. But if you are meditating, thinking you have to sit in the head and do all that and keep on thinking about the body and the head, we don't go nowhere. So once you are able to repeat the words, one important thing, very important feature. Repetition of words is not so important as listening to what you are repeating. Very important. The whole capacity of our soul in physical form is the capacity to listen. The capacity of the mind is to speak. Mind speaks, soul listens, always. They are built like that. Therefore, the listening capacity is very important. That is why the sound is so important, because listening is so important. And listening is coming from ourselves, from the soul. That is why when you repeat the words of Simran or any mantra you are using, repeat them slowly and listen to what you are repeating with attentiveness. Very important that you listen to what you are repeating, not merely repeat. When you merely repeat, your mind runs to everything else. When you listen to it attentively, then your attention goes on listening to the word. Listening is very important. So listening should start not when the sound comes, but even before that, when you are repeating the word, repeat slowly. Every syllable should be clear to you. And then you listen to it attentively, and that will help you to get the sound very quickly. As you develop your capacity to listen more, sound comes much faster that way. Now, when many sounds come, like I mentioned, they have listed 10 sounds that most people hear, and the 10 sounds can be like thunder, like an echo of something that has just been left behind, an echo sound. There's a whistling sound, the sound of crickets chirping, sound of bird chirping, sound of little bell ringing, all kinds of sounds are around there. Some are physical, arising from the physical body's movement, and you are putting attention on them, makes it very strong. And some are not physical, but astral, but not the real astral sound which pulls us. Not the sound of the self, but astral sounds. So that is why the aim should be to reach the sound of the self. The sound of the self, to start with, looks like sound of a bell, a big bell. And you can see it is coming from a distance. Other sounds appear to be very close to us. The bell sound is at a distance. When you can hear the bell sound, shift your attention from other sounds to the bell sound. You may not be able to hold it for long. Other sounds are strong. If it moves around, play with those sounds. Play with one sound or another and see when you can put your attention on the weaker, feeble sound coming from a long distance. As you put attention on that, the sound comes closer and closer to you. Now, if you feel the sound is coming from a particular direction, do not move toward that direction. Stay in the center. Stay in the center and let the sound come to you, not that you go in. Similarly, supposing you see your master in your imagination or in a radiant form and he appears, don't move towards the master. Stay where you are and master's image will come towards you. This is very important that you do not lose the center. This is all in the beginning. So once you have practiced, then automatically your center will be where everything will happen. So these are some of the tips I am giving you from my experience. When you are able to hear the sound, the bell sound, which will be very melodious, not the sound with a harsh ding-dong, that it will be continuous sound with a pattern in it, a sine curve pattern, with peals of bell. As you listen, the peals will become longer and longer. When you are able to meditate from your inner self by closing eyes, the same sound will be there. The peel will become one stretch of peel. And the color of the sky, your own, the feeling of the sky will change. That means you have entered another stage and you will forget the sense perceptions and the body with which you were meditating. Then you will find you have no body or something is around you. You are there, but you don't have hands and feet and all that what you had in the lower two levels. Physical level, astral level, we have the same extremities like we have here. But in the causal plane, they disappear and it looks like everything is happening by mental perception. It's a wonderful experience. In the beginning, sometimes one can get a little frightened. I must tell you that if you do these things too quickly, because they are so different from our reality here, they can cause a little fright. My recommendation is don't go too fast. We have waited millions of years for this opportunity. If it takes us little time now, don't worry about it. It's not that I want to get this ASAP. No more ASAP is here. We should wait and go gradually. If you have a little extension of your experience every day, that is much better than suddenly have an experience and getting frightened. I remember my own dad's case. My father was also initiated by the great master. And when he was so keen on it, he was a professor of philosophy, had been teaching metaphysics, was asking questions about soul and spirit and all, which they could not find from the professors. Some professor told him, go to the great master, he is a great professor of metaphysics. So he met great master in that context, and great master told him, this is how you can withdraw your attention. The sound. He was so keen that he very meditated and the sound came suddenly and he tried to listen to it attentively. His whole body was being vacated. He felt he was dying and he stopped. He said, I'm not going to do this kind of meditation. I thought I'm going to get something. I'm losing everything. I'm dying. So he stopped meditation. He went to great master and said, Master, this is no meditation what you taught me. I was virtually going to die by practicing that. And great master smiled and said, let me tell you something. Statistically, a person can die anytime. People die while holding a cup of tea in their hand. People die while they are walking. People die. Is it not a strange surprise that nobody has died while doing meditation? This is a strange statistic. Why are you worried? Look at the numbers. And then he said, supposing you were to die, everybody dies at some point, you die, what do you expect will happen? He said, I really don't know, but I'm expecting you'll be there. He said, that's a promise, I'll be there. Are you still afraid? He said, no, I'm not afraid. And then he did good meditation with good experiences. So this stage comes in our life if we are too fast and carried away quickly, and does carry away, I must tell you. That if the sound of the bell is very strong, it pulls you so quickly from the body, you feel. Because the experience of withdrawal of attention from the body is identical to the experience of real death. The withdrawal takes place from the body, the awareness takes place, awareness is pulled out from the body exactly as it is pulled out at the time of physical death. So that is why the similarity is so strong. And that is why they call it dying while living. It is an experience of dying while living. So my suggestion to you is, take it easy. You have found the way. So long as you are going in the right direction, don't worry about the time. The direction should be correct. If you are looking for answers outside, that's not the answer to find spiritual truth. If you are looking inside, it's the right direction. No matter how steady and slow you go, it's a good thing to take it easy. When you have little experiences every day, you never have any fear or afraid. When you have the inner experiences, I can tell you, all fear will disappear from you, from your life. All fear of everything will disappear. You become totally fearless when you discover the nature of this universe, the nature of creation, and how it is functioning. When you are in that state, there is no fear and no doubt. Doubt and fear, which are created by the mind as part of our life here, disappear when you are able to go to the higher stages. Especially when you are able to cross the mind, absolutely no fear and no doubt remains in your life of anything. So that's a wonderful thing. People are living in a life of fear, insecurity all the time. That disappears. So there are some what I call peripheral benefits. These are peripheral benefits that you experience right here in this world. In your own life, here you find the benefits of these experiences. So that is why, if nothing else, if you don't believe what is inside, at least you'll see the effect right here in this physical world. So meditation that way will be good. When you have entered the causal plane, the orange sky, the golden sky, you can stay there as long as you like. People spend the whole lifetime there. And many people believe that is the end of all our search. So even you may feel at the end of the search. Your master will be with there. And you will argue, Master, what else can there be? Even that kind of conversation can take place. Not in the same term, like with words, but we converse telepathically there. So you will be able to have an experience of the origin of the universes, all universes. Very big experience to have a knowledge of how all universes and how many universes. You will see universes being created in front of you. You will see universes dissolving and ending in front of you. What they call black holes and creations and so on, you will see yourself how they are happening. And you'll be able to travel at very high speed. When some of you had a flying experience, and I said, fly fast, high speed, upward. And some of you went very fast, but not as fast as you can travel in the causal plane. The causal plane, the speed of travel through the universes, is of the speed of thought. When you think of one thing, think of another, you are there. It's that fast. So you can explore a lot in the causal plane. Enjoy that. Spend your time there. No rush. If you are initiated by a perfect living master, no rush to go through any stage. Take your time. The master will definitely, without any doubt, take you to your true home, no matter how much time you spend on the way. Of course, some people don't want to spend any time on the way. They are not interested in sightseeing and all. They want to go straight to their home. Master do take them straight to their home. Sometimes they put blinders on those and they don't see anything. And they just come straight up to the Parabrahm and beyond the mind. So these things happen according to how you have brought up your seeking from several lifetimes. How the seeking has come up and then that what takes you. Beyond that, your role completely ends. You have no role to perform. The Master's love and his power will take you beyond the mind, beyond the causal plane. There, beyond that, there is a state of being. It can't be described because now we are losing time and space behind. And all I can do, all that has been done in the past, is to make stories to fit in with our concept of time and space. It's not exactly what we are saying, but just to explain, just to have some understanding, when you are crossing the mind and going to your own original state, first time you realize you are a soul. You never know before that what a soul is. We talk about it, it's a word, it's a feeling, but it's not knowledge. First time you know who you are, who yourself is, you discover when crossing the mind in a state which we also referred to as Parabrahm. We call it Parabrahm. because beyond Brahm, the Brahm is the end of the three universes of mind. So therefore, when Parabrahm is reached, you discover who you are. Now, Parabrahm has two parts. The first part is where you discover your soul, and the second part is from where you discover you are not an individual soul, but you are part of totality. Both are in Parabrahm. The nature of time and space, the whole creation over here, is based on the lower part. The importance of that can only be understood when we understand these universes we are seeing are not here permanently. They are created and dissolved, created and dissolved. When they are dissolved only up to the level, when they dissolve up to the level of the Brahma, or that be the causal state, what they call top of Trikuti, the three level of three universes, when they are dissolved up to that level, we call it that it is like a dissolution. When it is dissolved above that, it's called grand dissolution. So the dissolution, paralaya, they use the word paralaya, and mahaparalaya. The two words are used to describe the state at which point the entire creation gets dissolved into nothingness and then recreated. So mahaparalaya destroys even that part where you have discovered your soul, which is immortal. What happens? Discovery of that soul takes you instantly into the upper part, which is never destroyed, is actually a part of our true home. Now, this is not a geographical description, but we are putting it like that just for understanding that the upper part of Parabrahma is actually part of our true home, but separated from our true home. They are very difficult to give a description. Great master used to give a description that when you go on a mountain top, there's several ranges of mountains. You go to one mountain top, but your destination is the next peak of the mountain. You can see that mountain, but you are not there. Then you have to take a dip into the valley and go up again to your destination. You can see your destination from here, but you lose the destination after that till you get it back again. These are just ways of describing. The actual experience cannot be described. But it's good to know there is something like that. When the dissolution of everything, mahaparalaya, takes place, grand dissolution, the lower part of Parabrahma is also dissolved. Upper part, which is part of our true home and is permanent, that's our immortality exists, continues forever. But after that, there is another region of experience which is completely the opposite of all the experience we have had here, including the physical experience. It's an experience of utter, complete darkness. The reason why there's an experience after discovering our truth that there can be utter darkness is because everything that originates here has an origin there, and darkness that exists here has also have to origin. So there is a region of darkness. It is so dark that no amount of darkness can compare with it. You can put light of 1,000 suns and you still can't see through it. It's so dark. It's just a way of expressing the darkness. In that darkness, people who do not have a perfect living master, who has achieved true home beyond the darkness, masters are not able to take them out, take them through the darkness. So that is why they say that only the power and light of a perfect living master can pierce the darkness. Second problem with the darkness is revolves, which means if you enter the darkness and think you are coming out the other end, you come back to the same end or some other end. So it's been called the Bhavar Gufa. That means it's like a cave, which is revolving cave, revolving dark cave. So that area, only a perfect living master takes you. If you're not a perfect living master, he's a master who can take you to your soul. But not a perfect living master, you go up to Parabrahm. If he's a perfect living master who has reached the totality, he takes you beyond. When you reach beyond, the discovery is so immense. No words can ever describe that you have reached a totality in which everything has happened. This creation is not outside of that. The whole creation, all universes are being created there. Otherwise, it's not total. It's not separate from here that we are going to some other place. It can't be total if this is separate here. Nothing is outside of it. The whole process of illusion being used by consciousness to generate reality is happening there. Till we reach that, we are constantly feeling we are moving from one level to another. After reaching there, we discover all levels were there. We never moved anywhere. We were there all the time. We never left our true home, really speaking. We just left the awareness of it. The whole game is of awareness. That the awareness has brought us to this level. By awareness, we are transferring realities from one reality to another. And we discover at the end, the whole thing was at one place. It all occurred there, to the totality of consciousness. Nothing ever happened outside of totality of consciousness. Difficult to describe that. But it can be achieved with a perfect living master. That is our true home, where everything. People say, if we leave here and go to such kind of true home, will we miss people here? Everything that is here is there. Nothing is outside of it. We will miss nothing. We'll have an awareness of everything, including this level, astral level, causal level, spiritual level, parabrahm, and the truth there, all are there happening through a process which consciousness alone can create. That's our reality. Now, this is very difficult to explain. I'm just putting up a picture in front of you, and pictures are put in front of us also, just for the mind to be able to have an imagination of what it could be. But it's impossible to describe it. The problem with language is that we can only describe what the mind can understand. We can't. And mind cannot understand anything that is in zero time or zero space. Supposing I were to tell you now, I just saw a beautiful big mansion, huge, existing in zero space and zero time. Makes no sense. Looks absurd. But I can see it. How can somebody see a huge mansion existing in zero time, zero space? We can't. People say that no amount of logic, no amount of rationality can ever describe or see what is beyond the mind. Because of the nature of our experiences through the mind, it needs time and space for everything. It cannot contemplate anything beyond it. The only subject, according to Socrates and Plato, where we could go beyond this and see something is in mathematics. That's surprising that mathematics, which is just I thought it's only 1 + 1 = 2, things like that. But the description was mathematics can go into areas which mind cannot speculate or imagine. For example, for those who are mathematicians who are here, we all study some mathematics. Supposing I were to say, here is this glass of water. And I want to know how big it is. I can measure it. Its height, width, depth. I can measure the three ordinates of the glass. Now I say, let's make the glass smaller. I make it to half. 0.5. I make it to 0.5. And smaller and smaller, smaller, till I reduce it to what we will call zero. Now we think it has disappeared. Mathematics says no, it's still there. It's plus zero. I push it further, it can become minus zero. Have you ever heard plus zero and minus zero? Yes, mathematics has it. Not only that, I'll go further in reduction of size to minus 1 inch, minus 10 inches, minus 1 mile. Huge glass, see, we can never see nor contemplate. Mathematics can. So that is why the Plato, when he thought of his republic, that a true government should be run by a republic of 200 governors, and they should be children picked up from childhood, separated from their parents, so no other person can affect their neutrality. He said the training should be first good physical exercise. Give them for 20 years or 18 years something exercise. Make them strong. Then teach them various subjects. And then he gave the importance of mathematics. Mathematics should be taught at that stage, so they understand concepts which cannot be understood by the mind. These are concepts. The negative entities can exist below zero is a concept that the mind cannot visualize. There is no spectacle available for that. That is why we are very limited here in seeing things. But can you imagine what we cannot see can be experienced, can become part of our awareness, knowledge? And that is what this spiritual path offers. It offers us the opportunity to reach that state where you discover totality. Perfect living masters, when they come to us in their human form, and they walk amongst us in their human form, they are just like us. They come with the same system, the same way of appearing here, like we have appeared. They are born the same way. They live the same way. They die the same way. Their bodies are identical like us. Only difference is that at all times, those human beings are carrying the awareness of all the levels because they're carrying the awareness of totality. And they don't say they are the unique people, that they are carrying this. The potential for that awareness is in all of us. We all have that potential of totality in our heads right now, sitting in the physical body. They are also sitting in their physical bodies. These masters come in the physical bodies like us and carry that awareness of everything. That is why when we listen to them and we hear them talk about these regions, we can see that they are talking from what they are experiencing at that time, not from memory or not from previous experience, not from books at all. So that is why they are unique people in their awareness, very ordinary people otherwise. So ordinary people having an extraordinary awareness makes them perfect living masters. They do not come just to have a life. They come for their marked souls. They have come, they have appeared for similar souls like themselves, whose time has come, who prearranged that they want to go back when they get tired of these creations which they are coming to as an adventure. We come to see these creations, different creations, as an adventure. And we have made arrangement to go back. They appear at the right time. And they say, are you ready? And we are ready when we are tired of this experience. If we are not tired, if we are not fed up with what is happening here, we are not ready yet. They say, have a little more good time or bad time, or high and low. Have this time. When you're ready, then they take you back. The initiation by a perfect living master is merely a connection, reconnection. Time has come, let's go back. That's what it is. An initiation is not teaching how to meditate. You can learn how to meditate from all the books. I am telling you how to meditate even now. I'm telling you, if the initiation was how to meditate, I am initiating all of you right now. That is not initiation by a perfect living master. A perfect living master's initiation is that from that moment, he becomes a friend inside at the astral plane. He also becomes a friend at the physical plane. But physical plane, we have our mind, which have our doubts, we have some questions, we don't get the time. It's not the same as having a continuous association with the master inside. The master manifests inside from the time of initiation. It may take us a while to withdraw our attention to the point where he waits for us. He virtually waits for us. Great master used to say that a perfect living master on a spiritual journey by train, because we didn't have too many air flights at that time, by train waits for us at the railroad station. And he has tickets in his hand, two tickets, one for himself, one for us, to travel to the final destination, our true home. He waits for us there. Sometimes he gets a little anxious. Why are you so late? He nudges a little bit. But he waits there. When we go there, the journey starts together. Actually, our role ends there. If you are initiated by a perfect living master, our role is just to reach the railroad station, which is no more than the 10th door at the third eye center, where he's waiting for us. And that's simple. Rest of the journey is together. The master guides you and helps you avoid certain pitfalls, avoid certain territories that also exist there, especially in the astral plane. In astral plane, we have big duality, like we have here. The big duality means we can have heavens of great joy and pleasure of the world and other sensory pleasures are there, immense. And hell, terrible torture is there. Both coexist in the astral plane. One can, unguided, go into wrong territory. But with guidance, because the master is there with you, we do not go to the wrong territory. Sometimes I know some people have by curiosity, let's have a peep at hell also, because most of our friends might be there. That is why, not a good curiosity. You can get trapped. One Bibi of great master, Bibi Rakhi, there were three ladies who used to help master. And they were young girls, even there was some comment that the master must be carrying on with these girls and why is he keeping them. Some adverse publicity came in the newspapers also about the master having young girls with him. But anyway, they served the master. The one who was the tallest was Bibi Lajo. Her name was Lajo. Lajwanti, called her Lajo. She was hefty, tall, strong. So the others were no match for her. So when it came to taking care of the master, his house, his household affairs, she took over and pushed the others out. This is my job, my territory. And master did not bother about their ego games, who's taking what. He enjoyed the show. He said, okay, let this one stay here. The other one, who was tall, but not as strong, thinner and less stout, was Bibi Rali. And Rali then took over the next best job available, the kitchen, and cooked food for the great master. So she was assigned a kitchen separate from the main house. When the new house was built for the master, the earlier house which he inherited from Baba Jamal Singh, his master, was only a few huts, two, three huts to put together. But now a new house was built, which was predicted by Baba Jamal Singh that you will get it when you become a master. When that house was built, kitchen was built separate on one side, and there were steps going down from the main house, from the upper story, down here to the kitchen. So Bibi Rali was in charge of kitchen. She prepared the meal, put it on a big thali, that metal plate, and bring it there. And Bibi Lajo was standing at the door. My territory now. And she would take it. I used to see this show also. And I used to see a great master enjoying the show. For him, it was not a serious thing at all. Then there was a third one, short one. She was shorter, more humble, and she could not fight these two tall ones at all. So these two pushed her, you do seva outside. So she began to do seva in the langar, the larger kitchen, and would make chapatis and make things, singing shabds, singing songs, singing bhajans, and would be working there. Her name was Bibi Rakhi. And as it happened, a small small room in the new building that came up was given. Next to her hut was a house that my grandfather and my parents, they built up. And so she was our neighbor. The third one was our neighbor in the Dera. So she lived in there. But great master, every morning at 3 o'clock, would come out for a walk with his cane. And in summer particularly, I remember, because there were no air conditioning, no power there, we used to sleep outside. And he would, with his cane, wake us up. Time to meditate. He would suddenly get up. Yes, yes, master. And then we would watch. Has he gone away? And then go to sleep again. He was so clever, he would come back and say, no, I saw you going to sleep. So it was strange games, strange times when I remember those days, how we used to get up to meditate. Now the third Bibi Rakhi, who was in that house next to ours. We used to love her. I loved her a lot because she was so good. She taught me a lot of things about meditation also. It was a good company for us. My dad liked her also. So she used to have strange experiences. And once she was howling, crying, screaming in a little room. So we were the first one to get out to try to break the door to see if she's dying or what happened. So then some other neighbors who were on the other side also came out. And she was sitting inside screaming. We tried to talk to her. She wouldn't talk. Then we went and called the Great Master. The Great Master came and she wouldn't listen to anybody. When Great Master came, he said, "Where are you, Bibi?" And she said, "I am in hell." "What is happening there?" So she began to describe torture that people are undergoing as part of their karma. And we couldn't believe her description. It was worse than many books I've read about hell, what goes on in hell. And when we heard that, we almost screamed ourselves. But Great Master said, "Why did you go there?" "Out of curiosity." That's what I was telling you. "And why don't you repeat the five words I gave you as Simran?" "I've forgotten them. There's so much torture is going on. I have forgotten them." "Are they hurting you?" "No, they are not hurting me at all." "Why are you screaming then?" "I can't even stand what they are doing here." "Can you hear my voice?" "Yeah, I can hear your voice. Follow my voice and come out." And then she suddenly opened her eyes, put her head on his feet. And then he told us all who were sitting, 10, 15 people. He said, "You know, these mistakes can happen even after initiation, out of curiosity. Stay close to Master. When you have radiant form, stay close to Master. Don't try to explore these things. If you want to explore, go with Master. And you'll be safe everywhere." I'm sharing this with you because a lot of things can happen in meditation. So be slow and steady. Find the Master within. Stay with the Master. Start your meditation in the beginning by imagining the Master with you and having conversation with him. That will make it easy for you to have the radiant form of the Master, and the Master will be with you at all times. These are some of the things I am recalling from my own life, and with Great Master's blessings, with his grace, honor, he's given me opportunity to share them with you. So I'm very happy that I got this opportunity to share these wonderful experiences that I've had with Great Master. I'm sure many of you will have even better experiences and will be way ahead of what I have been saying. Also, some people are also talking about going beyond our true home. I might mention a few words about that. They say that you are calling Sachkhand true home. That's a translation of the word. Sach is true. Khand is our home. The place, true place, true hell. They say that mention is made of three more stages above Sachkhand. They are called Alak, Agam, Anami. In the literature that comes from Agra, where Seth Shivdayal Singh Swamiji started Radha Swami faith, they are mentioning that these three stages are even higher. And we go to the highest stage, which is Anami. Anami Desh, not Sachkhand. They are now, maybe tomorrow we'll invent three more stages beyond that. But about these three stages, I can tell you, because this great master explained at length, that when we are an individuated soul, like we are now, our journey ends at Sachkhand. There's nothing beyond. We merge in totality, and we call that being, the totality of consciousness, as Satpurush. It is Satpurush in whom we merge, and the region they are describing are regions of experience by the Satpurush. In totality, everything is there. But he can experience within that a state of being which they call, which cannot be named, cannot be explained. So they call them Agam, which cannot be known. Imagine, which cannot be known. The state is called that which cannot be known. Alak, which cannot be described or written. Anami, which cannot even be named. So these three stages are not traveled by the soul, but they travel by totality. So that is why we can say we can go there when we're part of totality. Yes, that is true. But this is not the journey, the spiritual journey we talk of, our own totality. And this, after totality, you can also have those experiences. What's the nature of those experiences? They contain everything that generates the totality. The totality experiences which have now manifest in this universe, all the universes, are being generated from those three regions, which are the regions which are a playground for Satpurush. Like we can play in this area, that area, and everything that we are seeing here has been generated from there in totality, and from totality then everything is created in the layers of experiences. So I just wanted to explain that to you. I am very happy that you spent time with me, and we will have prasad if it is ready.
Yes.
Prasad is blessed food. Normally we used to get prasad from great master. It used to be in the form of puffed rice, puliya, we used to call it, puffed rice. And we used to get it from him, from his hand. There were no bags available, the plastic bags. We are not that affluent to afford these things. It was comparatively poverty compared to what we have now here. So he would give it from the basket. He'd take it in his hand like this and deliver. And we used to take out our handkerchief, carry it in our handkerchief. If we didn't have, somebody didn't have a handkerchief, they took out their shirt and pulled out the shirt and got the shirt. Women use their scarf to use it, or sometimes their shirt also. So he would just put it there. And he would tell us, take a little at a time. Prasad does not change the nature, the structure of the product itself. It remained the same. Only the blessings of the master who is giving them made it prasad. Prasad is blessed food. The food is still the same blessing. And I'm saying that because I remember in India, many people said, my daughter is having fever, high fever, I gave her prasad. No, you should give her medicine for that. Give her Tylenol or something. And prasad can also be given for blessed food, but not as a medicine. So it is to remember the master. Every time we take prasad, we remember who gave it. So master would give it and we would remember the great master gave this prasad to us. And the connection of the prasad with the master was important for the prasad. So he said, take little bit at a time so we can remember him more often. So that's what we did. He also suggested, if for a long time you're not going to see me, then similar prasad you can buy from the market. Similar products you can buy from the market. When this supply goes low, buy some and put it together, mix it thoroughly. So you don't know which one is which. All of it become prasad. So you can extend the prasad like that. It is to remember the master. So I remember also, sometimes they were a little sweet in it. Especially on Bandara and special days, and they would put a few sweets. They've got patashas made of sugar. So little patashas were put in there, some sweets with them. And we as kids loved the prasad in which they were a patasha, one or more. I still remember standing in line for prasad when my turn would come. I would look like this. Can I see a patasha? No. Elder person, please, you are elder, go ahead. Patasha, I will go forward. So now I am told that instead of that, Patasha, they are using somewhere some other sweet, maybe M&M's or something. And if I were to stand in line, I'd look for the M&M. But I believe they are going to put in all of them, so there's no unique feature. Don't have to jump ahead of the line at all. So they will bring the prasad here, and I'll be very happy to give it the blessing of great master, my master. I am nobody to bless any prasad or anybody, but great master's power is there. Great master sits inside, and it is his blessing everything is happening. Whatever I've shared with you His great master sharing this, I can assure you. His great master's teaching that I shared with you. Nothing of my own, neither more nor less. It's all great master teaching I shared with you. Therefore, the prasad that is going to be distributed is also blessed with my master, who is visible to me and actually blessing the prasad, which you would be receiving. So please treat it with as much respect as you can. And please take a little bit of it every day, so that your memory of this event can last longer. I'm very happy at this time. So thank you once more. You have come from long distances. Have safe journey back and enjoy your journey. Tomorrow we'll be having Mitti Seva. Just a copy of what used to happen in the Dera. That means we were building the Dera buildings there, the Satsanghar there, and we used to carry bricks, we used to dig the ground, we used to carry basket of dirt and earth, mud, to different places, what was needed. It was a great experience to do seva of that kind. As I said, seva of every kind is good. And Mitti Seva particularly was useful, because in Mitti Seva, the ego was also reduced to dust. That nobody could know who was high, who was low. We all did the seva at the same time. There was a prince of a state, there was a ruler of a state doing Mitti Seva. There were millionaires sitting doing Mitti Seva. The very poor people doing Mitti Seva, all full of dirt and carrying the basket, no distinction left. Which shows how the spiritual path at that level looks that is meant for all equally. There is no high and low in the eyes of a master. All are equal. And therefore, Mitti Seva gives a good actual physical demonstration of it. So tomorrow, some of you are coming to have Mitti Seva. And normally on Mitti Seva day, I have other appointments and I only go for a short period for that event. But seeing that so many people could not get the personal time interviews, I've added a few hours more for personal time tomorrow and day after, of course, there was a whole day fixed for personal time. I hope I'll still be able to see as many of you as I can. But from next event, all other events, we'll have enough days that if you want a personal meeting, you'll get it. So long as you can find the time to stay on for that. So thank you very much once again. And let prasad be brought.